the Texas School Book Depository Building, Dallas. From this sixth-floor window, Lee Harvey Oswald allegedly fired the shots that killed the President of the United States on November the 22nd, 1963. Lee Harvey Oswald, a figure of mystery, murdered before he could reveal what he knew. While the truth about him remains obscure, the myths abound.
He was average Joe, that was all.
He was behaving like someone who was belligerent and not showing any remorse for anything he had done.
He was a nice fella, seemed like. Very courteous, nicely kept.
Oswald was the perfect Patsy. He looked guilty. Not just of the murder, but of anything.
A very sullen, dark kind of a man that I wouldn't want to be friends with.
He seemed to be such a nice man, and everybody thought he was, and he appeared to be, because he was very good with children.
And he started making a villain out of a man who genuinely was probably a hero.
Lee Harvey Oswald is a question mark to history. The debate is often raised, was Lee Harvey Oswald alone as the assassin, or was he part of a conspiracy? The question is never raised, is it possible he didn't do it at all?
6 weeks before the assassination, Oswald had taken a low-paid job as an order filler at the school book depository in downtown Dallas. Because of his impoverished circumstances, Oswald was living in the modest residential district of Oak Cliff, 4 miles out of town. Although married with two young daughters, weeknights were spent alone at this seedy rooming house at 1026 North Beckley, where Oswald had mysteriously registered under the name of O.H. Lee. Most weekends, however, he visited his Russian-born wife Marina and their baby daughters, who lived on the far side of town in the Irving district of Dallas. Unable to drive, he would hitch a lift with a fellow worker to this house, where his family lodged with the woman who had befriended them, a Quaker called Ruth Payne.
The idea of his having shot the president skews what everyone thinks, it seems to me, and we forget how ordinary he was, or how he would play with his children and with mine at the house on weekends. And my main memory of him is of his watching the football games on Saturday and Sunday, and he enjoyed watching the games on the TV set. He seemed concerned about his little girls, very much so.
Oswald loved being the family man. The colleague who drove him out to see them at weekends and lived only a few doors away witnessed that affection firsthand. Buell Wesley Frazier.
He liked children very much. That's one of the things that I could get Lee to talk about. When Lee came home with me on Friday afternoon and rode back on with me on Monday morning, I never saw him or did anything with him at that time, but evidently the children in the neighborhood, all of them at one time or other, seemed to find their way up to the Payne house where Lee lived to play with him and his daughter. On November the 21st, I was working at the Texas School Books Depository.
Oswald came up to me and he asked if he could ride home with me, and I said, sure. And then a little bit later, I realized it wasn't Friday. And the next time I saw him, I said, well, today's not Friday, Lee. He says, I know that. He says, it's Thursday. He says, Marina has made some curtains for me, and they have some curtain rods out there. And he says, I'm going to get the curtain rods to put the curtains up in my apartment. And I said, okay.
He had never come out without asking permission before, besides the fact that it was a weeknight. And he arrived, actually, I was out of the house when he arrived. I was grocery shopping. We bought a lot of groceries. and then he was there already, playing with his children on the front lawn when I arrived about 5:30. As we went by each other, I said, very, very happy in Russian, our president is coming. And he just sort of brushed on by without saying anything or no really reaction. And in a way that was typical of him, so I gave it very little thought. He often didn't respond very much. But I think that evening he was especially quiet at dinner, and he went to bed very early.
On the morning of the assassination, Oswald overslept. Leaving money and his wedding ring behind, he hurried down the street to secure his ride to work with Frazier. Under his arm, he carried a brown paper package. Did this contain the gun that killed the President of the United States?
The first time I saw the package, it was on the back seat of my car, and I just glanced at it. And I asked, I said, what's that, Lee? And he said, that's curtain rods. He said, remember I was going to bring them? The length of the package that I saw that morning was roughly 2 foot long, give or take an inch or two. And it was made out of the same type of packing material that you would find in any company that packed materials for shipment. It's just the brown paper and the tape that you'd normally find. Nothing unusual. What we actually talked about that morning was that I said President Kennedy is going to be coming to town today. And I said, you know, I've never seen a president. I said, I sure would like to get a chance to see him up close. Well, at that time, I didn't know that the motorcade in which he would be riding would come right by where we worked. He did not make any comment at all about where the president was coming to town. It didn't seem to interest him one way or the other. I parked in the parking lot at Texas School Book Depository. Lee got out of the car, took the package that he said contained curtain rods, and he put one end of the package in the cup of his hand and the other up under his armpit. He put the package under his arm that way, and he walked off toward Texas School Book Depository up on Elm Street.
The package could not have contained Oswald's rifle, for even when dismantled, it was 3 feet long. The Warren commissioners, who investigated the assassination, ignored Frazier's unswerving testimony, insisting the weapon had been smuggled into the depository in Oswald's brown paper parcel. Harold Norman, another of Oswald's co-workers, also found nothing unusual in his behavior that morning.
I saw Oswald about 30 minutes, I say, before the motorcade supposed to be coming through. And the reason why I know I remember seeing him is because he's an order filler and I'm a checker. So I have to check the orders and make sure that they go out correctly to where they're supposed to go. But meantime, after the, I seen him on the first floor, I didn't see him anymore.
As far as eyewitnesses go, there was a woman named Carolyn Arnold who spoke to Oswald on the second floor moments before the shooting. Now, the motorcade was running 6 minutes late. Oswald, had he been up there, would have had no way of knowing this. He would have been up there on the sixth floor. He would have been waiting for at least 10 or 15 minutes in that so-called sniper's perch to shoot at President Kennedy as he either came toward the depository or as he went toward the triple underpass. One way or the other, he would have had to be up there at that time. He wouldn't be in the lunchroom on the second floor.
Now they're waving, and here comes Jackie waving by. Mr. Kennedy.
President's car is now turning onto Elm Street, and it will be only a matter of minutes before he arrives at the trademark. It appears as though something has happened in the motorcade route. Something, I repeat, has happened in the motorcade route. There's numerous people running up the hill alongside Elm Street. Stand by just a moment, please. Put me on, Phil. Put me on. The motorcade is coming by here. The presidential car coming up now. We know it's the presidential car. You see Mrs. Kennedy's pink suit. There's a Secret Service man, spread eagle, over the top of the car. We understand Governor and Mrs. Connolly are in the car with President and Mrs. Kennedy. We can't see who has been hit, if anybody's been hit, but apparently something is wrong here. Something is terribly wrong. I'm in behind the motorcade, trying to follow them. It looks as though they're going to Parkland Hospital.
And just now we've received reports here at Parkland that Governor Connolly was shot in the upper left chest, and the first unconfirmed reports say the president was hit in the head. That's an unconfirmed report that the president was hit in the head.
A priest has been ordered. Emergency supplies of blood also being rushed to the hospital.
Just a moment. Just a moment. We have a bulletin coming in. We now switch you directly to Parkland Hospital and KBOX News Director Bill Hampton.
The president of the United States is dead. It's official. As of just a few moments ago, the president of the United States is dead.
What I remember is being told that it wasn't oral report rather than a visual one, that the president had been shot. And then it was really quite a while later that we heard that he had died. And when I first heard that he'd been shot, I went and got a little votive candle and lit that. And Marina said, is that a way of praying? And I said, yes, that's just sort of my way. We were both just very distressed, and, you know, let lunch sit on the table. Neither interested in eating as we followed the coverage. A little later on, life went on. We had children to take care of, and she was hanging out some laundry in the back line when I heard on the TV that the shots were thought to have been fired from the school book depository building.
Now riding the back trails of Texas, a former Dallas motorcycle officer recalls a remarkable encounter he had within 90 seconds of the assassination. The first policeman into the depository was Marion Baker.
I worked for Dallas Police Department as a motorcycle officer and signed the motorcade that day. I was approximately five or six cars back from the lead car of the motorcade. I had gotten about halfway between Maine and Houston when I heard these three shots. And immediately, I knew they was in front of me and high. And as I looked up, I saw this huge flock of pigeons flying from the top of this building. I rode my motorcycle over to the corner of the intersection, parked it, and then ran in the building, which took me a very few seconds to do this. When I got through the front doors into the lobby of the building, I asked where the elevators or the stairs would be. And one man spoke up, said, "I'm Mr. Truly, I'm the building manager." And he said, "Come on, officer, I'll show you." So he and I continued on to the back of the building and up some stairways at the back of the building to the second floor. As we came out of the second floor, I saw through a doorway, a window in this doorway, a movement. So I went over and opened up the door, and this man was walking away from it in the next room. I later found out was a coffee room.
As seen earlier by his fellow workers, Oswald was still alone in the lunchroom.
I called to the man, and he turned around, and Mr. Truly was there beside me, and I asked him if he knew this man or if he worked there. He said, "Yes, he does." He was calm, ordinary, you know. He didn't look excited or anything like that.
In order to fire the shots from the sixth floor, Oswald needed to squeeze his way out of the sniper's perch, pick his way between stacks of books to the far side of the building, hiding the gun en route, descend four flights of stairs to the lunchroom unobserved, and yet appear calm and unruffled in his encounter with Officer Baker, all within 90 seconds. Less than 15 minutes after the shooting, the police were broadcasting a wanted description that closely fitted Oswald. Who provided that description is not known, but it led to the immediate arrest of Oswald lookalikes, even in Fort Worth, 30 miles away.
Attention all squad. The suspect in the shooting at Elm in Houston is reported to be an unknown white male, approximately 30, slender build, height 5 feet 10 inches, weight 165 pounds, reported to be armed with what is thought to be a 30 caliber rifle.
Meanwhile, the real Oswald had made his way to a taxi rank a short distance from the depository, and after politely offering the first cab in line to another passenger, had asked to be driven to the street where he lived in Oak Cliff. At his lodgings, he rushed to his room, collected a jacket and revolver, and was last seen by his landlady shortly after 1 p.m., standing at the bus stop outside 1026 North Beckley. A mile from Oswald's rooming house, in another part of Oak Cliff, a further drama was unfolding. Waitress Helen Markham, on her way to work, was about to become the principal witness to a brutal slaying.
I was standing here on this corner, waiting on the traffic to pass so I could go down there and catch my bus to go to work. And a man come walking down the sidewalk, and a policeman came. And I could not get across.
The policeman in a patrol car was Officer J.D. Tippett. According to Helen Markham's account, Tippett stopped his car and got out to continue his conversation with the man on the sidewalk.
Just as the policeman got in front of the hood of the car, that man shot him three or four times. And then he put his gun back in his pants. He run over here, And I put my hands, I seen him coming, I just put my hands up on my face like this. I waited for a few minutes and I opened them up and I pulled them down. And he looked at me and I looked at him and I never said a word. And just like a flash of lightning with big glassy eyes, he run off across the field, out that lot there, down right across there, went over the fence and down the alley.
With Helen Markham, car dealer Ted Calloway was to become a principal witness for the Warren Commission. At a police identity parade later that day, they both picked out Lee Harvey Oswald as the killer of Officer J.D. Tippett.
I was sitting in my office when I heard what sounded to be five pistol shots coming from behind my office in the direction of 10th Street. Well, I jumped up, ran out to the sidewalk, and as I did, I saw a man jump through the hedge carrying a pistol. And he angled across the street to the sidewalk and continued to run in my direction, holding his pistol. When he got almost directly across from me, I yelled at him, "Hey, man, what the hell is going on?" And he had his pistol right here, and he nearly stopped, and he turned in my direction and said something, but I couldn't understand what he said. So he continued walking down Patton Street. I called to a friend of mine. I said, "Follow that guy, see where he's going."
The different routes taken by the fleeing assailant were not the only contradictions in the accounts of these key witnesses.
He was wearing a light shirt, a brown jacket, and a light gray trousers.
He was wearing a black pair of trousers, a white shirt, and either a real light tan or a light gray Eisenhower-type windbreaker.
He was a short man, tiny small, and with a ruddy complexion.
He had real fair complexion, dark hair, and I found out later, the reason he had such fair complexion, that he'd killed a police officer and he was scared to death. So what it was, he was as pale as a ghost.
This man has devoted more time and energy than anyone to investigating the murder of Officer Tippett in Oak Cliff. After 12 years, researcher Larry Harris has uncovered important new evidence.
The Warren Report concluded that Oswald had been walking east on 10th Street at the time he was encountered by Officer Tippett. And yet virtually all of the police, FBI, and Secret Service written reports from that weekend stated clearly that the man had been walking west on 10th Street, the opposite direction of Oswald. One of the witnesses to so state was Jim Burt, who was located on the corner of Denver and 10th Street. He sat on his front porch and stated he watched the man walking west on 10th Street up to the point where he encountered the police officer, and this is the man who did the shooting. The fact of the matter is that after 25 years, it's unclear just what transpired during the shooting here at 10th and Patton. One of the witnesses not known to the Warren Commission was a woman named Aquila Clemens, who was located in a house on the opposite side of the street. She came out immediately after the shooting and said she saw two men, one of whom was short and chunky, standing near the police car, and these men ran off in opposite directions. The bullets recovered from Tippett's body could not be traced to Oswald's revolver, nor apparently to any other revolver. There were references on the police radio tapes to an automatic weapon, two references. This is highly significant because Oswald was carrying a six-shot revolver, not an automatic. According to the Warren report, Oswald continued on in a westerly direction toward the Texas Theater and was able to reverse the six-block distance unimpeded, even though Jefferson Boulevard was swarming with police cars and bystanders searching for the suspect and closely scrutinizing any single white male that would have been walking in the area.
An agitated figure was seen to dodge into the Texas Theater without paying and disappear into the upstairs balcony. Butch Burrows was the ticket collector on duty that day.
We were playing two movies called War as Hell with Audie Murphy and Cry Battle with Van Heflin. And we started the movie at 1 o'clock. And I was carrying candy behind the candy case. And he also slipped in around between 1 and 1:07.
According to the official record, 1:07 was the time at which police officer Tippett was slain. Tippett's police comrades gave him a hero's funeral with all the pomp and ceremony that the city of Dallas could provide. Mrs. Tippett became a very wealthy widow. Donations poured into Dallas for the family of the police hero slain in the line of duty, confronting the presidential assassin, Lee Oswald.
I don't know what this is all about.
Back up, man.
Here in Dallas, the man all America is looking at this time is 24-year-old Lee H. Oswald, being interrogated at the Dallas City Police Building. At the time of his arrest in a theater in the Oak Cliff section of Dallas, he was subdued after killing a Dallas police officer with a snub-nosed revolver, struggling with another officer, striking him with that pistol. And during that struggle, he was heard to shout, "It's all over now. I got me a president and a cop, and I'll try for two more." A fanatic in every sense of the word.
McDonald yelled for help, and the other officers in the theater and I managed to subdue the man, disarm him, and handcuff him.
We asked him why he shot the officer, and he made the statement, "I haven't done anything to be ashamed of." This is all the information we got out of him on the way downtown. After we pulled into the basement and set up the wedge, we told him we would hold him in such a way that if he did not want his picture taken, he could duck down below the level of the outside guys walking around him and get into the station without anybody taking his picture. And here again, he says, "I haven't done anything to be ashamed of," and he did not try to hide his face in any way as we went in on the elevator up to the third floor and set him in the interrogation room.
Except for the arresting officers, I was the first investigative officer that talked to him. He said he hadn't shot anybody, hadn't shot an officer or anybody else. And the only thing that he would admit to was hitting an officer in the mouth. He said, or a cop in the mouth, is the way he put it. He said, "I will admit to hitting a cop in the mouth, but," he said, "I won't admit to shooting anybody." And his answers that he would give to questions were as almost like they'd been rehearsed.
"Sir, shoot the president." "I work in that building."
"Were you in the building at the time?"
"Naturally, if I work in that building, yes, sir."
"Back up, man.
The no, they're taking me in because of the fact that I lived in the Soviet Union. Did you shoot the president?"
The prime piece of evidence against Oswald seemed to be the antiquated bolt-action rifle discovered on the sixth floor of the depository 30 minutes after the assassination. However, both the FBI and the Dallas police were unable to positively tie the weapon to Oswald. This became a matter of increasing embarrassment to Police Chief Jesse Curry.
"Chief, we understand you have the results of the paraffin tests which were made to determine whether Oswald had fired a weapon. Can you tell us what those tests
showed?" "I understand that it was positive.
What does that mean?"
"It only means that he fired a gun."
Were there powder burns or powder marks on his cheek or on
"I don't
his
know that. I don't know
all
that.
All you know about on his hand." "Yeah.
That he fired a gun, Chief,
a gun.
Not the rifle or the pistol."
"That's right."
As the police tried to build a case against Oswald, officers were dispatched to question his wife, Lorena. They were led by Detective Gus Rhodes.
We drove to the 6th Street address in Irving, address of Ruth Payne, and walked up the walk, and as I approached the door, a voice said, "Come on in, I've been expecting you." Questions that I asked Marina, I said, "Does your husband own a rifle?" She said, "Yes." And I said, "Do you know where it is?" And she said, "Yes." I said, "Can you show it to me?" And she said, "Yes." And she motioned for me to follow her. And she directed me into the kitchen part of the house where she opened a door that goes into a garage. And she pointed out in the garage to a rolled up blanket that was laying out there. And she said, being interpreted by Ruth Payne, "That's his rifle."
And the officer picked up the blanket roll and, you know, just hung over his arm. And that was the point at which I felt that he could have been the one that killed the president. And I had this flood of feeling of, you know, what they need to know. I'm going to help them know whatever they need to know. We're going to get to the bottom of this. But that was the first I had any inkling that he'd even had a gun.
fire that rifle just as fast as you people have been given, but I emphatically deny these charges.
Basic fundamental hygienic rights, I mean, like a shower and the clothes.
These people have given me a hearing without legal representation or anything.
You shoot the president?
I didn't shoot anybody, no, sir. I'm just a Patsy.
There is no official record of Oswald's many hours of interrogation.
Well, I was in the process of transferring him. I had a short conversation with him, and where I said, Lee, if anybody shoots at you, I hope that they are as good a shot as you are. Meaning that I hope they, if they shot him, they'd hit him and not me. He kind of laughed and said, well, you're being melodramatic about it. I don't think anybody's going to shoot at me. And I said, well, in the event that they do shoot at you, you know what to do. You will be on the floor immediately. However, I didn't realize that just two or three minutes later, somebody would actually be shooting at him.
Even in Oswald's dying moments, the authorities desperately tried to wrest a confession from him. A surgeon, Paul Peters, of Parkland Hospital, explains.
There were Secret Service men intermingled with the operating room personnel, as there were dozens of people in the operating suite at that time, and some were dressed in green clothes as the surgeons, so as to be indistinguishable from operating room personnel. And since it was known by those in the operating room that he was under little or no anesthesia, two or three people shouted in his ear, did you do it? Did you do it? Which led me as a layman to speculate that perhaps a full-fledged confession might not yet have been obtained from Mr. Oswald.
Determined efforts by the Dallas police and the FBI in Washington had still failed to tie the prized rifle to Oswald. However, a smudged palm print was discovered on the weapon hours after a mysterious visit to the funeral home where Oswald's body had been taken by mortician Paul Grudy.
I had gotten to the funeral home with his body something in the neighborhood of 11 o'clock at night, and it is a several-hour procedure to prepare the remains. And after this time, someplace in the early morning, agents came. Now, I say agents because I'm not familiar at the moment with whether they were Secret Service or FBI or what they were. But agents did come, and when they did come, they fingerprinted. And the only reason that we knew they did, they were carrying a satchel and the equipment, and asked us if they might have the preparation room to themselves. And after it was all over, we found ink on Lee Harvey's hands, showing that they had fingerprinted him and palm printed him. We had to take that ink back off in order to prepare him for burial and to eliminate that ink. When we removed the casket from the little chapel, there wasn't any way that the help and I could handle it. Since there were only two of us, we decided the best thing to do. I solicited the newsmen that were there, and I asked them, would you mind helping me? And they volunteered and came over and carried the remains of the casket to the coach, and then from the coach to the tent after I drove over to the gravesite. There were enough policemen there, one behind every tombstone, because they just didn't know what was going to be the next thing to happen. When the minister was through with a few brief words, the family then was given the privilege of, as in the business we call it, the last leave. They had the opportunity to look at the body of Lee Harvey for a brief moment. And Marina, the wife, got up and patted his body and caressed him. Then she reached down and took a ring off of her finger, and actually it was two rings, and tried to place it on Lee Harvey's fingers, because this was the ring that was their wedding band, and I helped her because she was shaking and very nervous. Marina took a handful of dirt and made the sign of a cross on that grave, and then the family departed and went back to a protective custody.
But the man given such a simple burial in Rose Hill Cemetery was far more complex than portrayed by history.
Well, Oswald is a pretty interesting fellow. He's not nearly the one-dimensional character that the Warren Commission has painted him to be. He was in the Marine Corps and did very well. He had a high security clearance. He was stationed over at Atsugi. He was a radar operator. In fact, he was one of the guys that would track the U-2 flights over Russia. So it's not like he was the perennial loser that we tend to have this image of him now.
Some of the key pieces in the Oswald puzzle lie not in Dallas, but down in New Orleans, where he spent significant periods of his life. In an unbroadcast interview with a local radio and television station only months before the assassination, Oswald spoke about his life.
I was born in New Orleans in 1939. For a short length of time during my childhood, I lived in Texas and in New York. During my junior high school days, I attended Beauregard Junior High School. I attended that school for 2 years. Then I went to Warren Eastern High School, and I attended that school for over a year. Then my family and I moved to Texas, and I continued my schooling there. Then I entered the United States Marine Corps in 1956. I spent 3 years in the United States Marine Corps, starting out as a private, working my way up through the ranks to the position of buck sergeant, and I served honorably, having been discharged.
He had an honorable discharge, and then just a few weeks later wound up in Russia saying that he was going to renounce his American citizenship. And it's interesting that after he had supposedly said that, he was given a dishonorable discharge from the Marine Corps. It's fascinating that when he did go over to Russia and was introduced to the woman who later became his wife, his Russian was so good that she thought he was a Russian. So we suspect that he was trained. And it is known that the military in this country had training programs for defectors. And we suspect Oswald was in that program. We don't know it, but we suspect it.
A glimpse into his true role in Russia may have been revealed by the hesitant way in which he described his relationship with the American embassy there.
I worked in Russia. I was under the protection of the I was not under the protection of the American government, but that is, I was at all times considered an American citizen. At no time, as I say, was I did I renounce my citizenship or attempt to renounce my citizenship, and at no time was I out of contact or with the American embassy.
It's quite possible that his mission in Russia was sponsored by the U.S. State Department, which did participate in some fake defector programs back in those days. It's entirely possible, and it certainly would fit with the kind of person we think Lee Harvey Oswald was.
One person with no illusions about Oswald's role launched his own investigation into the Kennedy assassination in 1967. The former district attorney of New Orleans, Judge Jim Garrison.
He was employed by the Central Intelligence Agency, and he was obviously drawn into a scapegoat situation and made to believe, ultimately, that he was penetrating the assassination. And then when the time came, they took the scapegoat, the man who thought he was working for the United States government, and killed him real quick. And then the machinery, disinformation machinery, started turning, and they started making a villain out of a man who genuinely was probably a hero.
6 months before the assassination, Oswald had taken a mundane job with the Riley Coffee Company. But it seems his real activities were centered a few blocks away. From a small office on the corner of Lafayette and Camp Street, Oswald managed a local chapter of the pro-Castro Fair Play for Cuba Committee. Operating from an adjoining office was a sinister figure named Guy Bannister.
About Guy Bannister, it's difficult to say much about him because he always stood in the shadows and pushed someone else to the front. He was a strongly disciplined man, perhaps the outgrowth of his many years as a special agent in charge of the Chicago office of the FBI. But he was a key man in the assassination. And that's clear from the fact that Oswald's sheep-dipping, his being portrayed as a communist, was done out of Guy Bannister's office. So he was sheep-dipped for months as a communist by giving literature. Lee, hand this out today. This is your assignment. I came across the fact that Oswald, a private in the Marines, had taken a Russian examination. And I knew the privates did not take Russian examinations unless they were connected with intelligence. So that caused me to be curious about 544 Camp, which was the address stamped on one circular that they gave out one time before, obviously, Bannister told them, Lee, no more addresses. It turned out that was a side address of Guy Bannister's private detective agency. Well, I went down there to look at it, and I found myself not merely outside of Guy Bannister's office, but across the street from Naval Intelligence, across the street from Secret Service. Around the corner was the Crescent City garage, the garage for the intelligence community. And then two doors away, the Riley Coffee Company. I used to be in the FBI. I knew people in Naval Intelligence, and they were either across the street, around the corner. The whole intelligence community was there. And right in the middle of it was Guy Bannister having Oswald sheep dipped as a communist.
You're a Marxist? Well, I have studied Marxist philosophy, yes, sir, and also other philosophers.
But are you a Marxist? I think you did admit on an earlier radio interview that you consider yourself a Marxist.
Well, I would very definitely say that I am a Marxist. That is correct. But that does not mean, however, that I'm a communist.
What is the difference between the two?
Well, there's a great deal of difference. Several American parties in several countries are based on Marxism, such as Ghana. Certain countries have characteristics of a socialist system, such as Great Britain with its socialized medicine. These, then, are the differences between an outright communist country and countries which adhere to leftist or Marxist principles.
In your work with the Fair Play for Cuba Committee, what are you advocating?
We advocate restoration of diplomatic trade and tourist relations with Cuba.
Most lunchtimes, Oswald would leave work and stroll down Magazine Street to the Crescent City garage, where government agents parked their cars and had them serviced. One such agent was observed contacting Oswald by the owner of the garage, Adrian Alba. During his lunch break, Oswald often sat in this office, browsing through gun magazines and chatting to Mr. Alba, who was also a keen rifleman. Oswald showed particular interest in how to go about ordering guns through the mail. The authorities tried to tie Oswald to the ordering of the assassination weapon by a coupon allegedly found amongst his possessions, torn from a June issue of one of Alba's gun magazines. Oswald, however, had ordered his rifle from a February issue of the magazine.
When the president ends up being assassinated and the scapegoat grabbed by the federal government and killed before anything can be done to help him, turns out to be the man that Guy Bannister's been the tutor of all the time, you have to conclude that Guy Bannister was a key man in the assassination and possibly the most important man that we encountered in our whole investigation. But he's been dead so many years, it's a little hard to question.
Clinton, a sleepy country town 130 miles from New Orleans, and the unlikely venue for the further sheep-dipping of Agent Oswald. Less than 3 months before the assassination, he arrived here with two strangers. During his brief stay, he made several attempts to get a job, in particular the local state hospital. He is well remembered in neighboring Jackson by the town barber, Edwin McGeehee.
It was a lazy afternoon, traffic was slow, and all of a sudden this stranger walks in the door. Said, how about a haircut? I said, fine. I got up, he sat down, and we started chatting, and I said, how you doing? He said, fine. He says, do you know? He says, I'm looking for a job. And he says, do you know anything about it? You know any place where I can get a job? I said, the only place we have is East Louisiana State Hospital. But I said, do you know anybody can help you get on? And he says, I don't know of anybody. He says, I'm from New Orleans. And he said, I don't know anybody could help me. Well, I said, I can direct you to our representative, Mr. Reeves Morgan's house. And he jumped when I said it was a mental institution. He just jumped like that. And he says, do they have all kind of jobs there, like electricians? He said things like you say would make you remember him. That was my distinct impression. And he just didn't need a haircut. I don't know what he was up to.
Oswald could not drive, but nonetheless he took to the back lanes and found his way to the remote homestead of the local state representative, Reeves Morgan.
Well, I was in the house there burning some trash out of the fireplace that had accumulated, and I heard a knock on the door, and I got up, and there was a young fella. I invited him in, and he said he wanted a job over at the hospital. He understood they had a vacancy over there in the electrical department. He seemed like a nice young fella, about like the average fella, or maybe better than some of them.
I went to lunch on the day of the assassination around at my mother-in-law's house. She invited us, my wife and I, to eat. And his picture was flashed on the TV. And I said, my goodness, I said, I know that fella from somewhere.
I said, that's the same guy that was here. And Lee Harvey Oswald. He said, he introduced himself as Oswald, Lee Oswald, he said. And I called the FBI man down there, and he said he knew he'd been up here already, and that's the last I ever heard of them.
And I said, surely they'll be by, you know. And I kept looking for them. They never did come by. And I thought that was strange.
The reason why they wanted to get Lee Oswald into the Jackson State Mental Hospital was so that with a change of a document or two and picking up a doctor or two to testify for the government, they could make him appear to be insane. He was utterly sane, just as he was absolutely non-communist. But in the sheep dipping program that was underway, it was important to try and make him appear to be crazy.
Bitterly protesting her son's innocence to the last, a forlorn Marguerite Oswald believed Lee had been grossly misrepresented to the world.
Lee Harvey Oswald, my son, even after his death, has done more for his country than any other living human being.
3 weeks after I buried Lee Harvey Oswald, the Secret Service came to me and they said, Paul, did you see any scars, such as the scars on his wrists where he was supposed to have tried to commit suicide in Russia? And I said, of course, I wasn't looking for the likes of this, and really in my own mind did not feel as though I remembered much about this, but didn't remember seeing any marks of that kind. And the Secret Service agent told me at that time, well, Paul, we just don't know who we have out there in that grave.
That mystery did not end with Oswald's burial. Lingering doubts about the identity of the person buried at Rose Hill Cemetery, Fort Worth, prompted Oswald's widow, Marina, to have his body exhumed in 1981.
Being of Russian background and not truly trusting the American, she often wondered if his body was really there. So when it came the opportunity to possibly bring his body to the surface, she was most interested to know, is his body really there? Had somebody taken his body from the grave after the burial had been made? Well, that was her motive, partly. And then, too, I think she was interested to make sure that this was really Lee Harvey Oswald that was still there in that grave. At the time of the 63 of the burial time, I put Lee Harvey Oswald in a steel-reinforced concrete vault. That vault was hermetically sealed. The vault is guaranteed not to break, crack, or go to pieces. It's heavy concrete with steel in it, with an asphalt lining. And when I opened the grave in 81 and found that that vault had been broken, and the bottom of the vault was the part that was broken, the top was still intact, I noticed at that time that the casket had been disturbed. I questioned in my own mind what had been going on. When I opened that casket the first time, I sent my wife, Virginia, to Marina to tell her, yes, there is a body in that grave, because that was her concern. And then we did go to Baylor, There was an examination by a medical person who was a forensic pathologist. And she determined that, yes, these were the teeth of Lee Harvey Oswald, but it took 2 years for her to make that determination before the report was actually done.
The findings of the team are as follows. We independently and as a team have concluded beyond any doubt, and I mean beyond any doubt, that the individual buried under the name of Lee Harvey Oswald in Rose Hill Cemetery is, in fact, Lee Harvey Oswald. At this point in time, we hope that this puts the matter to rest without any further speculation being raised as to the identity of the individual at Rose Hill.
Oswald's dental record was used to confirm the identity of the exhumed body. But once again, the official version does not tell the whole story. Paul Grudy, an experienced mortician, made one vital observation that confounds their findings. He speaks about it here for the first time.
Of course, I was the one that had to handle the body in the morgue at Baylor. And as we removed the body from the casket, or at least worked with the body, I could recognize that this clothing was the clothing that I had put on that body. And yet, when I saw the head of this body, and it was removed from the casket and removed from the body in order that they might x-ray it and take pictures, I could see that there was no autopsy on that head. When an autopsy is done and the skull is cut in order to remove the cap, in order to remove the brain, there is a distinctive line of where all the fissures and all of the skull has been parted. Now, it's going to cause a bit of a mark. No matter what you try and do, it's going to show. And knowing that I handled the body originally, and there was an autopsy on that head, and now to see that there was no autopsy on the head, made it in my mind pretty clear that something had transpired that had caused this. And I feel as though someone had gone to the cemetery off hours, had taken the head of Lee Harvey Oswald that now was dead. How he got that way, I don't know, but at least it was the head, and had brought the vault to the surface as best they could, being a heavy item as it is, a tripod, lifting that body, lifting the body and the vault out of the grave. In the process, the bottom of the vault fell, breaking the vault, causing the casket to deteriorate to a degree. Then, of course, removed the head of the one that was there that had been autopsied and put this head in its place so that we would find the teeth of Lee Harvey Oswald. That's my theory. This is what I think happened. Whoever caused that was the same faction that caused the assassination in the first place, but it, in my mind, a cover-up had taken place.
Lee Harvey Oswald was not the individual who assassinated President Kennedy, nor was he the individual responsible for Policeman Tippett's death. I want to know why, after 25 years, the federal government of this country maintains that Oswald and Oswald alone was responsible for these murders.
The individual that I know is Lee Harvey Oswald. I don't think had it in him to be a person capable of committing such a crime as murdering the President of the United States. I'll always believe that. The side I saw to him was a very kind and loving man. And that's the way I like to remember him.
Lee Oswald was totally, unequivocally, completely innocent of the assassination. And the fact that history, or in the rewriting of history, and disinformation has made a villain out of this young man who wanted nothing more than to be a fine Marine, is in some ways the greatest injustice of all.